Hey, good morning, everybody. We're glad you're here this morning. We're going to be looking today in the scripture this morning at the place of the Word of God in our lives. And one of the things that James tells us is the Word of God's like a mirror. It just shows us who we are. It helps us to see ourselves as God sees us. What it says about us is true. We're going to start out singing this song together. Let's stand together and sing with full hearts to the Lord.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but He brought me in. Oh, His love for me. Oh, His love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, He has ransomed me, His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, He died for me.
The Lord today. So grateful that you've chosen to spend this Sunday morning with us worshiping the Lord. This is your first time here today. We especially want you to feel welcome with us. But those of you, this is your regular place of worship. We're grateful you're here as well. If you have a bulletin, I'd ask you to grab it. And you'll notice a couple of things are inside of it this morning. First, there is a Connect card. And we'd ask all of you, if you would, to fill the very front of the Connect card out and put it in the offering boxes that are on the wall as you leave today. And on the back of the Connect card, there's some places for you to communicate to us just how we can come alongside you and help pray and help in areas of ministry that you may need help in life. You may choose to have someone to help disciple you, and just there's some places on there that you can connect with us and also respond to the sermon after the message. And so keep that handy, and we would encourage you to do that. There's a second little piece that's also in the bulletin that says Northwoods Church VBS destination. Vacation Bible School starts this evening. We divided it up into two groups of 2 3-day vacation Bible schools, and it starts this evening. And we give you this for two purposes. One is that if you know a family that you'd like to hand this off to, we would encourage you to do that. Invite them to come to Vacation Bible School. Secondly, put this in a place that that you'll be praying for Vacation Bible School this week. This will be a week that we'll be giving the gospel out to kids this week, and helping them, those kids who know the Lord, that they would grow in Christ. And so we're very grateful you're here, and this is, I'm always excited about Sunday because we're able to come together and put our focus on the Lord, and I want to encourage you to do that right now. Would you bow with me as we worship the Lord and go to Him today in prayer? Father, I come to You today, and I thank You that, Lord, You are faithful and You are good. I thank You that You love us. I pray that, Lord, today would be a day that we would remember that You have given us opportunities to lift You up, to recognize Your grace and Your mercy. And, Lord, You've called us to live in such a way that glorifies You, and that Lord, You would be pleased. And I pray that, Lord, we would be doing that. I pray that, Lord, as Darren has mentioned, that we would allow Your word today to be a mirror in our own hearts, in our own lives. Lord, many of us have had a hard week. Life has beaten us down. Lord, I pray that today we would find You as a refuge and a strength, a very present help in a time of trouble. Lord, we're able to come to You and know that You're salve to our wounds, Your healing to our soul, Your forgiveness to our sins. And I pray, Lord, we would find You as the one who meets our needs. Thank You that You're worthy today to be worshiped. May we worship You well today. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me as we sing to the Lord?
These next couple of songs talk about the strength of the Lord, that there's nothing too difficult for Him, that He is the lion, and He is strong. And so we're going to sing these songs. The first one may be new to you. It's a new one we're learning this morning. We'll try it together and see how we do. Ready? One, two.
Oh my soul, don't
mention of his name. Let's sing this together.
Nations bow, mountains shake at the sound of just one name.
Will bow down.
God, we're grateful for your strength, that there's power in your name. There's power in your word. Lord, it is our aim to come before you this morning and build our lives on who you are, build our lives on your word. Lord, I pray that today that we would approach this time of looking at your word as just submitting ourselves before you, offering ourselves to you. And Lord, where there's areas of our lives where we may be resistant to your working, where we may be resisting your voice, God, I pray that today we would find ourselves newly committed to obeying you, to obeying your word, that you're worthy. And we want to offer ourselves to you. We want to offer our praise to you. You're worthy of everything that we can give. So we give in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing this song. Thank you.
song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. We live for you. We live for you.
Be seated. If you have your Bibles this morning, would you take them and turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter 1. Book of Psalms, chapter 1. I'm going to do a series starting this morning called The Summer in the Psalms. Someone asked me, more than one have asked me, where are we going to be in God's Word today? And I told them Psalms 1. And everyone, when I said that, they said, that's going to be a long series. I'm not preaching the next 150 weeks out of the book of Psalms. So I was with a group of people, and they were about 3 weeks ago, and they were two or three of them were talking about how they were mountain climbers, and what they did was they climbed mountains of over 14,000 feet. They are idiots. Okay? 14,000 feet. We're comparing. How many of you climbed? How many of you climbed? How many of you climbed? They looked over at me and I said, none. I was sane. But what they were doing was they were proud of their, you know, their accomplishments, and they were all trying to figure out which ones are they going to climb next. What I'm going to be doing in the summer in the Psalms is I'm choosing high peaks. We're going to visit high peaks. It happens to be Psalm 1, Psalms leads off with a high peak. The first two psalms are both unnamed in who the writers are. They're orphaned, as they're without author or inscription. Psalm 1 will give information about the law. Psalm 2, which we're not going to be addressing next week, but Psalm 2 will give information on the prophets. You might remember that all of the Old Testament hangs on the law and the prophets. There's even a parallel passage on Psalm 1 that's found in Jeremiah 17. The psalmist desires each of us to know, to experience God's blessings, and to warn us about the path of sinners. That's what Psalm 1's going to do. Today we're going to see a description of the godly man and the ungodly man. This psalm is divided neatly into two sections. The godly man who's blessed, and a godless man who will be destroyed. This is a powerful passage. This is a passage that you should memorize. I mean that. There's six verses. You should memorize Psalm 1. It is easily memorized, and you should memorize this passage. Would you be kind enough to stand with me as we read the Word of God, then you can sit for the rest of the message. It says this. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law does he meditate day and night. He is like a tree planted by the streams of water, yields its fruit in its season, its leaf does not wither, and all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so. They're like the chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the ways of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Let's pray. Father, I pray in the next few moments your Holy Spirit would do a wonderful work in this room. And I need that to be true in me. May you search our hearts, and may we be obedient. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The first thing I want you to see is a description of a godly man. It's going to be he will be described in two ways. First, he will be described negatively. Notice in verse 1, blessed is the man, so he's described blessed. You could say happy, and by the way, it's happy plural, happies. Lots of happies. Blessed is the man, who walks not in the counsel of the wicked. Catch that? Walks not in the counsel. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked. There's nothing wrong with being friendly with unbelievers. Nothing. Jesus is called friend of sinners. But there is something clearly wrong here with walking not in the counsel of the wicked. Why are we talking about walking? Notice the word walk. The term walk, by the way, if someone's walking, it's okay. We know it. What's the term walking about? It's a regular, consistent interaction. That's what the passage has up here. By the way, I'm going to show you some things on the screen today that I don't normally show you. I'm going to show you some things that are on the screen that I have in my Bible. Okay? So, for example, I have in my Bible the word walk circled. Okay? I would encourage you to mark up your Bibles. And so, walking not should be something I would encourage you to circle. Walk not. What does it mean? The idea when you're walking with someone, there is a regular, consistent interaction. My wife loves to walk. I like to walk if I'm throwing rocks at squirrels. Okay? That sounds bad, doesn't it? It really does. I will not say that in the second service. I like to walk if I'm doing things. Okay? But I have learned, we will be married 30 years this year. And so the process of now, I've learned to not throw rocks at squirrels when I'm walking with my wife. I've learned walking with my wife is enough. It's consistent interaction. We walk and we talk. We walk and we talk. But watch the passage. Something else that you should circle. Who walks not, watch this, in the counsel of. Y'all aren't supposed to be talking. Walks not in the counsel of. I knew I chose the wrong person when John Warren was involved. The counsel of. Notice who you're receiving advice from. I talked to someone over here a little while ago. Normally when I preach Psalm 1, teach Psalm 1, I'm in jail. Psalm 1 is, I'm always teaching Psalm 1 when I'm in jail. Why? Because they can't stop walking with the wrong people. They're always receiving wrong counsel. Walk not in the counsel of. They're listening for advice with people they shouldn't be listening to. Specifically, notice a third word you should circle, the wicked. Walk not counsel of wicked. Who are the wicked? Those who are far from God. You should not be receiving advice from, walking with, getting counsel from the wicked, people who are far from God. If you walk with them, why is this a problem? If you walk with them long enough, you will start believing like them. So where do you receive your counsel? Where do you receive your advice? Good, godly people? Ultimately, you will believe what they believe. That's what happens. Notice with me, if you would, how the passage continues. This verse 1's got a lot of things to underline. Walk, counsel, wicked. Watch the next. Nor stands. You see how walk and stands? You got walking and then you got standing. How is that different? All of a sudden, when you're these guys who are walking, they all of a sudden stop and they slow down from their walk, and there's a progression. Notice the next word. Stands. In the way of. It's a part of. Stands in the way of. They've joined. We've almost said, okay, I've been walking a little while, but I think I'm getting close to hanging out with and making this group mine. If you stand with them, ultimately you'll just demonstrate you behave like them. Notice the third, in the way of sinners. In the way of sinners. It's in the path of those who miss God's standards and they don't care. They don't care what God's standards are. I'm reminded of the biblical story of Abraham and Lot. Abraham and Lot, they argued. Their group, their herdsmen argued. And Abraham told Lot, you choose any area you want to go and you go in it. And Lot said, well, I'm going to choose the high plains. I'm going to go up here on the high areas and I'm going to go towards Sodom. And ultimately he did, and he lived toward Sodom, but the next thing he knew, he was standing in the gates. He didn't just walk with them, he stood with them. In the way of sinners, their behavior reflects those we stand with. So who do you stand with? And there's the third group, the end of verse 1. Nor sits. You see how it goes? You walk, you stand, and then you sit. It's amazing how that happens. At some point in time, everybody needs a lazy boy. You know what I mean? That was a great time for somebody to say amen. We slow down, we sit, we're reclining with. And it's official. It's official. We behave like they behave. We believe what they believe. We have slowed down to sit with them. Notice the phrase, we sit in the seat of. We've joined the group. Think of, for those of you who think college, think of a professor's chair. You're sitting in the professor's chair. Think of Moses' seat. If you sit with them, you demonstrate you belong to this group. Well, whose group? Notice at the end of the last thing in verse 3, or verse 1, nor sits in the seat of the scoffers. These are people, you have gone from walking not, standing not, walking with, standing and sitting, and now this is a group of scoffers. They literally make fun of Christianity. They make fun of the Word of God. You hang out with them long enough, this is the path we go on. He says, I want you to be blessed. And blessed, this is what you better not do. Don't walk with this group. Don't sit with this group. Don't stand with this group. Go the other way. You know what? If we have people in this church, we have people that I'm talking to right now who have an addictive background. You're coming out of alcohol. You're coming out of drugs. I'm so glad you're here. But for those of you who come out of an addictive background, you know that what I'm about to say is true. You have to have a whole new set of friends. You can't have the old set of friends. You have the old set of friends, you go right back into that stuff. You can't. You start walking with them, start standing with them, start sitting with them, you'll start doing it again. Some folks in this room, you've come out of jail. You have to have a whole new set of friends. You start walking with them, start standing with them, start sitting with them. You go right back into the same old path. What we don't talk about very much, some of us come out of a past of immorality. You start walking, you start sitting, you start standing with that group, you're going to go right back. But a whole new set of friends is hard, and I really like those folks. I'm not talking about whether you like them or not. I'm talking about we have to walk different, we have to stand different, we have to sit different to be godly people. Things have to change. And very first verse says, this is described negatively. Now the passage describes positively. Thank you, guys. I don't believe y'all are all wicked. Thank you. I'm kidding. I'm not kidding. I don't think you're wicked. Thank you guys very much. Notice how this is described positively. Look in verse 2. But, that's another word worth looking at. Flip it. But, his delight is in the law of the Lord. On his law, he meditates day and night. The goal of the godly man is to experience blessings, happiness. And it comes from, yes, what you don't do, but places you don't go, but it also comes from something you do. The opposite of the one who walks the wrong way is the one who's blessed, and that one is one who is delighted in the law of the Lord. They're delighted in it. So literally, they only had, as when the Psalms were written, they had Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. They had five books. So when they're talking about the law of the Lord, we're talking about five books, and they're basically saying, you need to be delighted in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. You and I have 66 books, 39 in the Old Testament, 27 in the New. And I can tell you at least some of them are more interesting to read than Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And you and I have the opportunity to be delighted in the Scriptures. To read it. You say, well, some of it's hard. Read it, read it, read it. How do you become delighted in it? Watch the passage. On his law, he meditates. If you meditate long enough, you'll start becoming delighted. It actually happens. Meditate first, delighting comes. Well, when do you meditate? I love how God's word answers it. Day and night. You read the word of God during the day. And look, I am confident I'm not the most godly person in this room, which I'm sure gives a lot of you confidence. But when I go to bed at night, the most encouraging times of my life have been the few times, not the many times, the few times that when I have gone to bed and I have gone to bed thinking about the Word of God. And I would wake up in the middle of the night thinking about the Word of God that I went to bed thinking about. Could I encourage you to think about doing this? I don't know how many of you have trouble sleeping. But when you can't sleep and you wake up, I have an idea. Meditate on the Word of God. The more you meditate on the Word of God, first of all, how can that be bad? We meditate on all kinds of junk in the middle of the night. Why can't we meditate on the Word of God in the middle of the night? And it just may be medicine for your soul. And you go to bed thinking about his word. bed dreaming about it. When you're meditating on the Word of God, you start asking questions like this when you're reading it. Are there sins in this passage for me to avoid? Are there promises in this passage for me to claim? Are there truths for me to understand? What's the main point of the passage? Because you're reading it, you're reading it, you're asking questions. And then the passage does this. It describes in verse 3 a godly man, and it describes him. Look at verse 3. He is like a tree. Okay, so it's going to give an allegory, giving a picture of a tree. And so I'm going to do the same thing I did earlier in verse 1. I'm going to show you some things that I underline or circle in my Bible. He is like a tree. Watch the first thing I circle. Planted. Why? The word planted, what does that say? It says that there is intentionality. Okay? It says a person goes... My son's a forester with the U.S. Forest Service just on the east side of Yellowstone in the Shoshone National Forest. Yesterday, he went to Du Bois, Wyoming, and picked up a bunch of seedlings so that they could go and plant trees to reforest a forest. The reason why you pick up the seedlings is because you have to have intentionality to plant trees. This was a person who is saying, I am intentionally plant. You say, well, I'm going to become godly and it's going to become by accident. It never becomes by accident. You want to become a godly woman? You want to become a godly man? It will never be by accident. It's because you're going to say, Lord, please work in me and I'm going to go to work. I should like go into an invitation right there. Are you ready to do that? Are you ready for there to be some intentionality in your life that basically says, I'm willing to go to work and there to be an intentionality of godliness in my life? Notice what the next thing I circle. Streams of water. Well, why? Because there's going to be droughts in your life that will affect others around you. But this is not going to affect this person. Why? Because he's drawing on a source that will not run dry. He's planted in a place. Is life going to stink? Oh, baby, it's going to stink. You're going to have less money than you wish. You're going to have not as nice a car as you wish. You're going to have not as nice a house as you wish. Your 401k is going to be like a 102. Are you picking up what I'm putting down? I mean, honey, it ain't going to shake out like you wish. But you invest in Christ. In 100 years, it'll be worth it all. There's streams of water. Trust Him. Know that He's going to care for you. Notice the third thing. Watch it. Planted by streams of water that yields its fruit. He's productive. You know what that production does? Makes him a blessing. Why do you plant the tree? You plant the... When I was growing up, my mom and dad had these peach trees. Every now and then somebody would tell me that they're peachy, and I'll say that just means you're fuzzy. Because I used to go out in the backyard and I'd pull a peach and I just remember all the peach fuzz on the outside. Mom and Dad taught me to wash the peach and I'd start chomping. I love peaches. Awesome. Nothing like it. Yields it's productive. It was a blessing. That tree was a blessing. But watch the next phrase. Yields its fruit in its season. You're to be productive, but you're not to be a freak. You're not always productive. Did you catch that? He's productive when he's supposed to be. There are times for fruit bearing, just like there's times for rest. Did you catch that? productive when you're supposed to be. This is the Christian life. The Christian life says you are to put your faith in him, trust him, and recognize he's going to use you when he chooses to use you, and when he doesn't choose to use you, you trust him. Why? You're his. You said, well, this is one of those times I don't really know what God's doing. Rest. But you better be available, because he's planted you. Notice the next phrase. And its leaf does not wither. My forester son would go nuts with this verse, because this means he's an evergreen. And evergreens are not fruity. So this is an allegory, guys. Okay? His leaf shall not wither. He's an evergreen. He's not affected by winter. He's not affected by weather. You can always look at this godly person and say circumstances don't affect him. Notice the last phrase, and the last phrase this says this, in all that he does, he prospers. You can almost circle the whole verse, can't you? Some of y'all are tired of circling. He's blessed, irrespective of the outside environment. Look, this passage tells you a ton about being godly. You want to be godly? Right here. Right here. This is the deal. This is the passage. Verses 1, 2, and 3. I've got 8 or 9 minutes, and I'm going to tell you about being ungodly. I'm going to tell you don't do it. I should say amen and go, right? Let me tell you the final things about being a godless man. Look at verse 4, 5, and 6. The godless man, notice the very first thing in verse 4. The wicked are not so. First of all, know that they're called wicked. You know, when we talk about a person who doesn't know Christ, you have two descriptions here, the blessed person and the wicked person. The godly person is called blessed. The ungodly person is called wicked. Some of us were like, well, I'm not wicked, but I'm not blessed. Like, I'm not really what you've described, Bobby. But I'm not wicked. Is there like a third category? Isn't there like a middle ground picture? And when you read verses 1 through 6, there's two. That's it. Now, I do believe that there are blessed people who for short periods live wicked, but they can't live wicked long term. Soren Kierkegaard, a Danish philosopher, told a story about a goose who was wounded, who landed in a barnyard with some chickens, and he played with the chickens, he ate with the chickens, and after a while that goose thought he was a chicken. One day a flock of geese came over, migrating to their home, and they gave up a honk up there in the sky, and the goose heard it. Kierkegaard said this: something stirred within the breast of that goose. Something called him to the skies. He began to flap the wings he'd never used. He rose a few feet into the air, and he stopped, and he settled back again into the mud of the barnyard. He heard the cry, but he settled for less. Only two groups. For those of you who know Christ, make sure you're not settling over here. Passage today outlines two possible lives: a blessed life, a wicked life. That makes me uncomfortable, but it's what the Word of God does. Notice how it's described. Verse 4, the wicked are not so, but they're like the chaff. The wind drives away. Chaff, what's that? I used to go dove hunting as a kid. My dad used to take me dove hunting, and we'd go out into these cornfields that were cut, and you'd see the husk thrown by the wind. Chaff is like that husk. It's rootless, it's weightless, it's useless. And he says the wicked are like the chaff. They're rootless, they're weightless. But what was the godly like? They were like a tree planted. The wicked are like chaff, blown. They have no purpose to their life. Verse 5, the wicked will not stand in judgment. It may seem to you that people around you, people of stature and influence, and man, on the final day of judgment, person of influence, God's going to reveal who they are. Look, when a ship has no engines, it will be blown by the wind. It has no control, and it will ultimately be driven to disaster. The wicked will not stand in judgment. The day of judgment for the unbeliever will not be a day that the unbeliever will like go before God and tell God off. Revelation 20, it says that the earth and sky will fly away before God. If the earth and sky is going to fly away before God, you are not going to ever tell God off. In a literal sense, this passage is saying the wicked will not stand in the judgment. It is saying the wicked will not have a leg to stand on. They will be on their face before God. Standing to be judged, we will blush at our own sin. We will be ashamed. Notice at the end of verse 5, interesting phrase. It says, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. What's up with this? My question, as I'm reading this week, I'm studying it over again. Why is it talking about the congregation? I mean, this is a congregation right here. Why is it talking about congregation right here about wicked? Why? Here's why. In every congregation, there are sinners who are wicked. Every righteous congregation, there are still sinners. There's wheat and tares. Within every congregation, there are sinners lost and on the path of destruction. One day, there will be unbelievers that will possibly in this room will stand before God, and they will one day stand before him and recognize they built their life on sand, not on a rock. Last verse, verse 6, there are only two ways. The Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Look, the way of the wicked will perish. Hell is real. Way of righteous, verse 1, 2, and 3. Where are you? This is like, I didn't know how Darren was going to start the service, but this is like, okay, Psalm 1, here's the mirror. How's it going? Godly, ungodly. Where you at? Philip Yancey, in his book, What Good Is God?, shares the story in the 2004 Ukraine election, which a reformer named Viktor Yushchenko challenged the entrenched party and nearly died for it. The exit polls showed Yushchenko with a comfortable lead, but through outright fraud, the government in Ukraine reversed the results. Yancey wrote this. That evening, the state-run television reported, quote, "Ladies and gentlemen, we announce that the challenger Viktor Yushchenko has been decisively defeated. However, government authorities had not taken into account one feature of Ukrainian television. The translation it provided for the hearing impaired. On the small screen insert in the lower right-hand corner of the television screen, there was a brave woman raised by deaf, mute parents who gave a different message in sign language. She said this, "I'm addressing all the deaf citizens of Ukraine. Do not believe what they are saying. They are lying. And I'm ashamed to translate these lies. Yushchenko is our president." No one in the studio understood her radical sign language message. And inspired by that courageous translator, deaf people led what became known as the Orange Revolution. They text messaged their friends on mobile phones about fraudulent elections. Soon other journalists took courage and likewise refused to broadcast the party line. Over the next few weeks, as many as a million people wearing orange flooded the capital city of Kiev to demand new elections. The government finally buckled under the pressure, consenting to new elections, and this time Yushchenko emerged as an undisputed winner. Yancey makes the following point. Our society is hardly unique. Like the sign language translator in the lower right-hand corner of the screen, along comes a person named Jesus who says, in effect, don't believe the big screen. They're lying. It's the people who are blessed, not the rich. Mourners are blessed too, as well as those who hunger and thirst and the persecuted. Those who go through life thinking they're on top will end up on the bottom. Those who go through life feeling they're at the very bottom will end up on top. After all, what does it profit a person to gain the whole world and lose his soul? And I would say to you as well, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law does he meditate day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. He shall bring forth fruit in its season. All that he does shall he prosper. The world will tell you being blessed is a picture over here. This is the mirror of the Word of God. You going to line up to this? Would you bow your heads with me? Today. Where are you at? There's some people you're walking with you shouldn't be walking with. Some people you're standing with you shouldn't be standing with. You're not delighting in the Lord as you should. You're in a situation today that put your focus on him in ways that you haven't. Trying to be godly unintentionally. You need to do some things intentionally. Follow Christ in a better way. I really want you to think for a second. I don't want to blow through this. For those of you who are in this room, you know Christ. What are the things that you need to change? Sort of circle your little chair and think of you. What needs to change? Let's ask Christ to help us make that change. For those of you who are in this room, maybe you're the sinner in the congregation of the righteous. You're at church, but you don't know the Lord. You're religious, but you don't know the Lord. I want to encourage you right now. Call on him. Give him your life. Ask for his forgiveness. ask Him to be the Lord of your life. And know that He's our hope. He's done all that's necessary for us to know Him. Father, I love You. I thank You for loving us. I thank You for Your faithfulness to us and for Your grace. I pray, Father, that today You would help us. Lord, we would respond in obedience to You. Forgive us for where we have sinned and we've lived separate from You. May we be a people who live obediently according to Your word. May we delight in it and meditate on it. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Bobby. If you'd like to respond to the sermon today, we've got two Next Step tables that are here in the sanctuary. We've got one over here where Pastor Bobby's going to be, and one of our lay elders, Jeff Irk, is back there at the back table. Wave, Jeff, so everybody can see you. He's back there. If you want to find out what it means to be a Christian or give your life to Christ or talk about baptism or joining the church even, we would love to talk to you after the worship service, so head to one of those tables back there. If you're watching online, howdy. We're glad that you are watching online with us today. What we would ask that you do if you are watching online is respond with a virtual connect card just to let us know that you're watching. You can text the word connect to 812-214-1987. We need like a jingle for that phone number. 812-214-1987. I'll work on that. Okay. I'll work on that. All right, in the 10:45 service, we're going to have two new members, Jackson Ellis and Colleen Morris. Of course, they're not here, but that's very exciting, to two more people joining our church. After the second service today, we have an important town hall meeting. These are our meetings where we communicate the church strategy and business, and we just talk about what's going on at Northwood, so we would encourage you to stick around or come back for after the 10:45 service for our town hall meeting. Today is one of my favorite days of the year. It's Vacation Bible School Day. Yeah, it's also the day I get to wear a t-shirt in church, so that's a good day as well. So Vacation Bible School starts tonight at 6 p.m. It's going to be a great time for your kids to learn about Jesus, and I'm so excited. This year's theme is Destination Dig, and we're going to be digging up God's truth, and we're going to learn a little bit about archaeology this week. A couple questions that I've gotten this morning already that I can answer for you. If you haven't registered your kids already, please send them anyway. We would love to have your kids and any neighbors, friends, kids, kids you pick up off the street, just come on and bring them all here. We would love to, yes, don't pick up any kids off the street, okay, please. But we would love to have any and all kids we have permission to take here to church. But also the other question I've gotten is, we have two blocks for this year of VBS. A through L last name goes Sunday through Tuesday, and then M through Z goes Wednesday through Friday this week. I've gotten the question, can I switch which block my kid is going to? Absolutely. So please just bring your kiddos. We'd love to have them. All right, next is there is a women's pool party. And no dudes are allowed at this at the Irks house. It's going to be on June 12th. There's going to be burgers and sides, and they're encouraging you to bring a 2-liter, a dessert, and a lawn chair. And this is a photo-free zone, so leave your camera at home. And ladies, you can swim without people photographing you, so please, it's going to be a good time. Remember, we're still recording our gospel conversations for the year out in the lobby with our ping pong ball display. If you have shared the gospel with somebody, write their name on a ping pong ball or their initials, or you don't have to put anything on it at all if you want, but just help us to understand that you've shared the gospel with somebody this week. Drop a ball in the ping pong ball display if you've done that. Offering will be as usual. As you enter and exit, there are little white boxes by the door. Drop your connect cards and your offering there. And you can always give online. You can do that a couple ways. You can give in the boxes. You can give online. by going to our Northwoods website, www.northwoodschurch.org/giving, and you can give online that way, or you can text to give at 812-214-1987. Text the word give to that phone number and then follow the prompts. All right, guys, I'm going to pray for us, and then you'll be dismissed. Father, as we leave this place today, Lord, I pray that we would heed the words of Psalm 1. Lord, I pray that we would not be people that listen to the word and do not dear the word, but do the word. But Lord, I pray that you would instill the words of Psalm 1 in our hearts, Lord. I pray that we would surround ourselves in community that just loves you and influences us positively. And Lord, I pray that we would not sit or stand in the way of sinners. And Lord, I pray that we would share the gospel with those that need it. Lord, we love you. We thankful for this time. And we ask for your safety and your protection upon us till we meet again next time. It's in your name I pray. Amen. Have a good week, guys.